Welcome to a world where everything is bright and sunny, but underneath the surface lies a dark world behind your safe little havens that you all call home. Beneath the surface, there's an evil that festers and grows where the American dream goes dark. This is the Literary License Podcast, America Goes Dark episode. Your book to screen show where we head down a dark alley and discover the books, the films, and all the darkness in between. With your co-host Leandro Gazzi, Craig Johnson, David Grant, Vicky Ray, and Keith Shago. Things may look perfect on the outside, but what really goes on behind closed doors?
They'll see, and they'll know, and they'll say, "Why, she wouldn't even harm a fly, a fly, a fly, a fly, a fly."
Oh, shit. Hello, welcome to the Literary License Podcast, and Merry Christmas. It's December, and we'll be doing our books of screams with We Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson, and the film from 2019 or 17. 18,
ain't it?
It is from 2018, yes.
So, I love it when I'm right.
So, who do we have with us today? We got Craig Johnson with us. Hello, Craig.
Hello from me, essentially, everybody.
Leandro Gazzi with us. Hello, Leandro.
Hi, how are you?
Vicky Ray with us. Hello, Vicky.
Hi, everybody.
And I'm your host, Keith Shago. And before we get started, let's find out what we've been up to. Starting with you, Leandro. What have you been up to since last time we spoke to you?
I've been training, since August, but now I've lost 7 kilos so far. So back on track on the gym. Working. More or less the same old. Getting ready to go to Argentina now on the 13th for Christmas. So, yeah, can't wait.
Nice. And what about yourself, Craig? What have you been up to?
Just been working, and I've started my new job on Monday, working at the head office, and I've been watching Wednesday on Netflix.
Y'all liking that? I only watched the first episode. It isn't singing to me yet.
Oh, it's excellent. I love it.
I mean, I just got to give it more of a chance. It just seemed like more goth girl stuff. That's all. It's just like, come on. But
it's like a
That's what Wednesday Addams is. She's a goth.
Well, she is a goth girl. I know, but I just said it's like, I don't know. It just seems like it's totally gotten away from the universe, I guess, a little bit.
Yeah. No, I loved it. I loved every moment of it.
I'm only up to the second episode. I got to give it more of a chance. Everybody said they loved it, so.
I like that Danny Elfman's doing it, and I like it's good to have Tim Burton working with the guys from the Addams Family movies.
So. They are working together.
Yeah. It was a good combination.
She's really cute. Who is that actress? It's driving me nuts.
Jenny Ortega. She was in X.
That's Jenny Ortega. That's how much I need to watch it then, I guess. Doesn't even look like her. I didn't even see who the credits were.
She's our screen queen for 2021 and 2022.
It's looking that way. We have been treated well this year, horror-wise, I have to say.
But I like all the Easter eggs in it as well. It's got some great Easter eggs in it. And Wednesday as well.
Like what? So. Like give me one Easter egg. I haven't seen it all yet, so.
Well, it's got the secret entrance to the secret society. That's an Easter egg. There's also Cousin It's picture. His ancestors. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
How come no one really incorporates Cousin? Unless Cousin It's just like a lot of work, I'm imagining. Or he pops up later in the show, maybe?
We used to call a girl, a friend of mine called Liz, we used to call her Cousin It because she never
had a lot of hair.
She was always freaking out about getting a haircut. So we called her Cousin It.
Well, why would she get freaked out about that?
And what else are you up to, Craig?
Just looking after my mum because my mum's had a hip replacement operation, so I've just been caring.
How's she doing?
Yeah, she's a lot better than she was, and she's healing well. We've got the carers coming in as well, so she's fully supported. Thank God.
Oh, good.
Well, tell Hoppy we've been asking about her.
Yeah.
Is that her nickname?
The physio came to help her up the stairs and called her granny.
Which aw, you guys picking on her. It's no fun, you know. Y'all mean. You're mean.
I think they've taken her phone away because she hasn't been texting me lately.
You're probably irritating the poor woman.
She does say I've got to give...
convalescing, okay?
Yeah, she says I've got to give Keith a break. Because I'm like, text Keith. She's like, no, I can't text him. I'm sending him too many messages. I was like, okay. But thank you for your help as well in getting it sorted. It was amazing. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. I'm glad we got it sorted out. Got it done quite quickly for her. So we got her off that 2-year waiting list.
Dr. Ebenezer. Yeah.
I have a little bit of pull.
A little bit of pull. He's cocky, isn't he?
Yeah.
She was on a 2-year waiting list, and I got her moved up to.
Did you really? Month. That's fantastic.
So, yeah. I think I got Craig's thing quite quickly as well. Got him from a 25-week wait to a 2-week wait.
That's terrible, though. 25 weeks.
Yeah.
We have there is a big problem here with the National Health Service at the moment. Yeah. So.
Rather we were dead before.
Well, we don't have any, so at least you've got something to complain about.
Yeah. So unless you're really sick and it's really like having nothing at all. So.
Or we just go to the emergency room here.
That's where we're sending everyone now because we have no space for anything at the moment. So, but
well, we're having a massive outbreak of RSV and flu. So,
yeah. Well, ours is not flu. Ours is just still business management, but it is what it is. So,
Well, we all know how the medical has been run over the last few years. We all got a good peek at it. We all know what's going on now.
Yeah. And what about yourself, Vix? What have you been up to?
Not a whole lot. Found out I got a surprise ticket to upstate New York or northern New York to go freeze for a week after Christmas. And I've been watching all kinds. Just been watching the. I'm not a huge soccer fan all the time, but I have been watching this one because I remember like 4 years ago, my friend took me globetrotting, and the one thing that stuck out in my mind is no matter what country we were in that year we went, everybody watched the Gold Cup. We went to Istanbul. They were watching the cup there. We went to Thailand. They were watching it there. We went to Morocco. They were watching every single country. And so it kind of made me feel good that at least the globe was united on this one thing, you know, everybody's watching something and there's at least a little good, you know, goodwill maybe towards everybody at this time of year. So I find that a little inspiring around this time of year. But other than that, I've just been watching my scary movies and finding all kinds of weird shit, like that Batman, 1940s Batman. I don't understand how anything was considered. What were they thinking? Even 1940, 50? I mean, the outfits are just killing me. Like, it looks like somebody wadded up two socks on Batman's head. It's just goofy as hell, but it's funny, you know, but... Other than that, I've been reading. I found a real good book cache. So I've been trying to watch some of that. Also, I found this little gem on Tubi. It's called The Secret Sex Life of Hitler. Strongly advised to watch it. I mean, these weird ass movies just pop up and I go, you know how it always says for you? And it's just like, well, I don't know why they're picking these for me, but I will give it a ride. And I was laughing because we all know Hitler had one testicle, but you know, we didn't really know why he had one testicle.
Well, I was watching over a lockdown. I think it was in Netflix. I watched it with a friend. Basically, Hitler was the son of two cousins, and when two cousins that are like near have a babies, there's a high chance that they are born with anomalies.
Right.
So, what they were saying in this documentary is like, Hitler's dad was a cousin of his mom, and when he was born, he had one testicle. And well, sorry, we're talking about this in the podcast.
Well, everybody's used us by now. You should see this other crap. Do you ever listen to any of our other podcasts, Leandro? It gets worse than this, man.
and he have a problem. He have a problem with the ureter. So technically, yeah. You know, you have one hole where you pee. Well, he has two. So when he was peeing, it's like the squirt was coming from another place. So that's why when he was a kid, he was kind of like, they were being bullied about that he was peeing himself all the time.
How did this guy get to be a massive dictator? I'll never understand. It's these little men with these little problems, and they're all freaked sexually, and they all become dictators. It's like, how does this happen?
Well, because the mind has to compensate.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. What did I watch? I watched this thing called The Texas Killing Fields on Netflix, too. I don't live very far removed. I didn't even know this story happened. That, you know, I was really young and I didn't live in Texas. But if you get a chance to, well, you probably, you know, skin in the game. But I had no idea. We had two serial killers working simultaneously back in the day. And they were dumping off women in this field. And I never heard about it. I never even knew this was going. It was a really interesting documentary anyway. They did catch one of them. But that other guy, he's still out there. And they know, you know, just weird stuff like that keep coming up for you. So I end up watching for you. So Tubi and Netflix picks me out the best stuff. Mm. Anyway, what's going on with you, Keith?
I had a literary agent contact me and they're representing me to write a book, which I started writing now.
I'm writing a book
at the moment.
So
I really enjoyed your short story that you sent, by the way, too. I really liked it a lot.
Yeah. Well, I had a short story that's been shortlisted. I'll know on the 15th of December whether I won or not.
If I like it, you have to win. All that matters is what I like.
And that was Catch You If You Fall. So, and then I had this literary agent contact me last week and ask, and they said they really want to represent me and if I have considered writing a book.
Did they read something that you had out there randomly, or is it word of mouth?
It's a short story that's up for competition at the moment, I think. So, you know, so I finished up, I'm finishing up this other short story at the moment that I've written with Ahmed at the moment. So I'm finishing that off. So, and then, I started working my book and it's basically, funnily enough, I don't write horror when I write short stories and novels.
Well, that short story was kind of leaning that way. I mean, I thought it was going to have a really bloody end there for a while, but I was really happy how it ended. So.
Yeah, I mean, it adds darkness to it. This one is called The Isolated Loner, so we'll see how it goes.
It seems legit. I like your outline.
Yeah. So, and then outside of that, I finished watching Wednesday, finished watching Dead to Me, which was really good.
I still haven't started that one.
Watching Tyler Perry's Sisters at the moment, enjoying that. Dragula on Shudder, which is
if you
like RuPaul, Dragula is even a lot better because it's all the bitchiness, but it's horror drag queens.
I love really RuPaul.
Gory and disgusting.
I haven't seen that. It looked really good, and I'm glad you reminded me. I totally forgot about that.
It's good. It's you know, each episode comes out once a week, so that's very good.
Yeah. So it's still ongoing right now. This is their latest season.
Yeah. I think it's got like two or three more weeks to go, and then it should be finished. So
who's showing it?
It's on Shudder.
It's on Shudder. Okay. I didn't know it was on Shudder.
It started out as a YouTube series, and it ran on YouTube for 2 or 3 seasons, then Shudder bought it. So now it's got a little bit higher production value to it. But it's fun. It's really good. I mean,
it looks fun. Those guys are funny. I'm sorry. I love or hate them. They are just entertaining as all get out. They just
well, RuPaul's like very PC, and this is not PC at all. This is like
he's not being PC.
Not Dracula. Dracula, they hate each other. I mean, they're just like, oh, I mean, they're just
no
like
kidding. Usually,
each other.
There's
oh,
like
they're...
unity and flowers. And
oh
unicorns.
No, there's no yeah, no, not with Dracula. No, these people are just this is like real people. So.
Right, that gives me more incentive to watch. I'm glad you reminded me. I've got to start that today.
Well, I think it's also because they know they don't have to go for a mass market, so it's like, oh, we don't need to go for a mass market, so we're gonna do it.
Well,
you know,
if
we're
anything,
be real.
RuPaul has stood the test of time, love or hate them, you know.
Yeah.
So I think they're entertaining. I love watching what they do. I just got this weird fixation. How do they? That men can put on makeup better than me. It's just annoying, in a weird way. I would let them work on me. Just for the afternoon, just to see what would happen. It'd probably be fun.
a little bit of vanity goes a long way. That's probably why they can do it so well.
Apparently, this is my uniform, you know, this is what I wear.
So, and then I got my Christmas shopping done and tree up and everything's done. So waiting for my next couple weeks and then voila, off from work. So
are you off from work for a long extended time yet or?
I haven't decided if I'm going to take off between Christmas and New Year. Christmas falls on a Sunday, so we get 2 extra bank holidays on Monday and Tuesday, and then we get the bank holiday after New Year as well. So, I haven't decided yet.
I don't want to go alone. You need to fly to Northern New York, so I don't have to be there by myself.
I wouldn't be able to get home. That's the problem. So, yeah, but, I mean, so yeah, just getting ready for that. Teed off the people at work, so that was interesting.
Not tell me what happened.
Well, there's 60 people in our department, and the Christmas party can only accommodate 25. So they asked me why I wasn't going, and I'm sorry, but I can't go to a Christmas party. It's not inclusive. They got really upset with me.
So, you are such a hypocrite.
I wouldn't have gone. Strange. Don't make a Christmas party and not everyone can attend.
I know.
It's not inclusive, he said.
I said, I can't go because it's not inclusive. And our hospital loves the word inclusive. They use it all the time. So they looked at me like,
where is this equity and inclusion now?
Yeah. But I mean, I wouldn't have gone anyway. So, I mean, I was just being a bitch, so what else can I say?
I try to avoid company parties. I've just had too many bad experiences.
I don't like them. I mean,
parties for corporate.
it's very rare that I go. When they go, how come you don't go? I go, I see more of you than I do my cat. Well, I don't want to see you outside of work hours. So
I always go if there is a raffle.
A raffle? You feeling lucky, Leandro?
Well, the first time I went to the Christmas party, I won a TV, a 14-inch TV.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
I never win shit, wow. Man.
That's good.
And it was amazing. You know, I won the TV, right? Then I went to the toilet, and I was peeing. And then, I was in the cubicle, and then I heard that 2 people talking. I said, oh, you see, that bloody bastard of Leo won the TV. I said, yeah, I can hear you. I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa.
Well, just as
they
long as you
inclusive
were
inclusive at your parties.
Just as long as you were not urinating like Hitler would have.
Yeah. Just pretend you have 1 testicle and you'll be fine.
Are you looking for a graphic design that will take you to the next level? Or something that shows confidence within a growing market to help you stand out amongst the crowd? Amazing Designs gives consistent and on-brand designs, whether you are looking for something conservative or you want to let your imagination soar. They bring professionalism to a high standard, and they're able to visualize your ideas and give them that extra edge. Working one-on-one with their designers will give you a design that will live up to your expectations and more. Affordable, expert designs for all occasions, whether it's logos, brochures, or whatever you can dream. dream of. Amazing Designs is your to-go place for creativity and hands-on expertise. Try Amazing Designs today. Contact them via email at amazingdesigns505@gmail.com. That's amazingdesigns505@gmail.com. Or reach out by phone at Crunchy Cold 1-805-203-0427. We love them so much here at the Literary License Podcast that we use them ourselves. But I'd rather be different than be the same.
And on that note, let's go to We Have Always Lived in the Castle, which is a 1962 mystery novel by American author Shirley Jackson. It was Jackson's final work that she wrote before she died, and it was published with a dedication to Pascal Covici, the publisher, 3 years before the author's death in 1965. The novel is written in the voice of 18-year-old Mary Katherine Merricat Blackwood, who lives with her agoraphobic sister and ailing uncle on an estate in Vermont. 6 years before the events of the novel, the Blackwood family experienced a tragedy that left the three survivors isolated from their small village. The novel was first published in hardcover in North America by Viking Press, and has since been released in paperback as an audiobook and an ebook. It has been described as Jackson's masterpiece. It's the first screen adaptation appeared in 2018, based on the screenplay by Mark Kruger and directed by Stacey Passan. What we're going to do is cut to synopsis of We Have Always Lived in the Castle and be right back.
We Have Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson, the synopsis. Mary Katherine Merricat Blackwood lives with her elder sister Constance and their ailing uncle Julius in a large house on extensive grounds in isolation from the nearby village. Constance has not left their house in 6 years, going no further than her large garden. Uncle Julian, who uses a wheelchair, obsessively writes and rewrites notes for his memoirs while Constance takes care of him. 6 years prior to the story, Constance and Merricat's parents, John and Ellen, their aunt Dorothy and their younger brother Thomas died after being poisoned with arsenic, which was mixed with the family's sugar bowl and sprinkled onto blackberries at dinner. Julian was also poisoned, but survived. Merricat was not present at the time as she had been sent to bed without dinner as punishment. Constance, the only member of the family who didn't put sugar on her berries, was arrested and charged with murder, but ultimately the verdict proved her not guilty. The people of the village believed that Constance got away with murder, leading them to exclude the family. The three remaining Blackwoods have since grown accustomed to their isolation, leading a quiet, happy existence. Merricat is the family's sole contact with the outside world, walking into the village twice a week and carrying home groceries and library books. On these trips, she is faced directly with hostility of the villagers and often taunted by groups of children with an accusing rhyme about the poisonous sugar. Merricat is protective of her sister and practices sympathetic magic that maintains borders around the house. Merricat feels that a dangerous change is approaching, but before she can warn Constance, their estranged cousin Charles appears for a visit and is welcomed into the home. Charles quickly begins to have a close relationship with Constance and gains her confidence. Charles is aware of Merricat's hostility and is increasingly rude to her and impatient of Julian's weaknesses. He makes many references to the money the sisters keep locked in their father's safe and gradually forms something of an alliance with Constance, encouraging her to leave her home. Merricat perceives Charles as a threat and tries various magical and otherwise disruptive means to drive him from the house. Uncle Julian is increasingly disgruntled by Charles and suspects that Charles came there for the Blackwood's fortune. One night before dinner, when Constance sends Merricat upstairs to wash her hands, Merricat, in a fit of anger, pushes Charles' smoking pipe into a waste paper basket filled with newspaper. This soon causes a massive fire that consumes the family home. The villagers arrive and help put out the fire, but then finally unleash their long-repressed hostility towards the Blackwoods by vandalizing and ransacking the home. Driven outdoors, Merricat and Constance flee into the woods after being threatened by the villagers, while Julian dies of an apparent heart failure during the fire, and Charles attempts to take the family safe. While Merricat and Constance shelter for the night under a tree Merricat has made into a hideaway, Constance confesses that she always knew that Merricat was the one who poisoned the family. Merricat readily admits to the deed, saying that she put the poison in the sugar bowl because she knew that Constance would not take sugar. Upon returning to their ruined home, Constance and Merricat proceed to salvage what is left of their belongings,
close off the rooms too damaged to use, and start their lives anew in their little space left to them. The house, now without a roof, resembles a castle, turrets and open to the sky. Constance and Merricat spend much of their time watching the outside world through peepholes hidden by the vines that grow to cover the house. The villagers, feeling remorse at their actions, begin to leave food on their doorsteps, while developing stories about the house akin to folklore. Charles returns once to try to renew his acquaintance with Constance, but she ignores him. The sisters choose to remain alone and unseen by the rest of the world. And that is We Have Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson. Now back to the show.
Hello, welcome back to Literary Legends Podcast. We're discussing We Have Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson. And starting with you, Craig, what are your thoughts of this book?
Yeah, I liked it. It was a nice read. It was a nice mystery. And I really liked the sister who did all the spells.
Merricat.
Merricat, yeah. She was really interesting and really quirky.
Yeah, to say the least.
I sort of felt for her as well, because when I know she's got the agoraphobia and going out, and you know, I know what that's like sometimes, you know, when you just don't want to go out of your house or face stuff and you just want to stay somewhere safe. And, you know, even going to the shop can be troubling for some people, you know, and especially when she had all the stigma of what the villagers thought of.
They were awful. They were nasty, horrible people.
Yeah. So,
And they actually track down, they think that the town, well, I guess Shirley Jackson lived in North Bennington, Vermont, and they're thinking that's probably, and I believe it if it's Bennington, Vermont. That's probably what those people are like there. Sorry, listeners, if you're from Bennington.
Well, Shirley Jackson, I mean, we interviewed Lawrence Hyman, Shirley Jackson's son, when we first started the podcast 6 years ago.
Yes,
but she was ostracized from her town where she lived. It was a college town, and they were kind of ostracized, and her husband was very jealous of her as well, because he wanted to be a writer, and of course she's the one that kind of took off and sort of thing. But she does have these kind of similar themes of being ostracized, you know, like The Haunting of Hill House, or became the movie The Haunting.
Every story she has is about isolation. If you've ever noticed it, it's about isolation. Yeah. Most of her stories, because I never really read a lot of Shirley Jackson, but she could like possibly be my new favorite author, because I really loved this book.
It was a nice class as well for the book. It was a nice read.
I thought it was a really good read.
It's very punchy the way she writes as well. It's kind of like everything's very matter of factly sort of thing. I mean, one of my favorite stories by Shirley Jackson is The Lottery. I mean, if you ever get a chance to read anything, the short story, it's my favorite all time short story. And basically, it's about a small town that, you know, it starts out normal enough. You know, woman's hanging out her clothes out to dry, and they're all gathering in the square, and they're having a bit of a gossip, and then the lottery starts, and then the woman who's like, you know, just, you know, late because she was doing her dishes and getting her, you know, putting dinner on the table or getting dinner ready for later on, she gets called, and basically she's like, oh no, it can't be my year, and then the whole town stone her to death. Because every year they do this lottery where they stone someone to death.
That is a really skeevy story, too, when you think about it. It's scary. You know, I mean, it doesn't have a lot of horror to it, but the concept of the lottery in itself is really a disturbing topic, the way she wrote about it.
Even when you're reading about Hill House, it's like, you know, you're reading, some places are born evil and all this other stuff. And then you go to Eleanor, and then you're reading about Eleanor. And it's basically, she's like, you know, she's living with her sister, that, you know, she's paying all the bills, but her sister's using her, and she just kind of goes there, and she's kind of normal. And then she's just, but in all that fact, she's isolated from everyone she knows. And then she ends up at Hill House. And so, but it's like, when you read her books, it's like, you're just reading like everyday life. And then all of a sudden there's like this dark thing starts happening underneath everything.
But they resonate. Her style of writing resonated with me quite a bit. And I really never really sat, other than Hill House, and he sat down and read another one of her books. And the way I mean,
I like Hill House.
Yeah, yeah. She's. I didn't realize how not prolific. I guess like you said, she writes about everyday people, and it resonates with you, but it gets really convoluted and takes a lot of twists and turns. So she is a really gifted writer, and I never really appreciated her enough until I read this book. So I was kind of glad we read this one.
I mean, she has. I mean, you know, if you think that her stuff was written like, you know, late 40s, early 50s is that when she started writing. And of course, she died in 1965, I think. So this is her last book that was published. But, you know, if you think about her stuff, it's so ahead of its time. It's just like,
for the 50s and 60s, yeah, it is.
Yeah, but some of it's still ahead of its time as well. I mean, you know, if you look at Stephen King or Clive Barker or Graham Masterson, and they say, if they ask you who their favorite author is of all time, Shirley Jackson's in their top three. So
she had definitely something about her that's not even remiss. I mean, I just love, like, the first paragraph, I think I texted you. I go, oh my God, I go, Mary Cat is my spirit animal. I already love this book. Yeah. It's totally believable, because who really, I mean, I used to be very outgoing. I like concerts and doing stuff, but now it's just like, God, people have turned into such assholes. I don't want to leave the house for the most part anymore. You know, I can totally relate to this book. It's just like, why do you want to do that to yourself? Why do you want to go out into it? You know, people don't like you, or they're judgmental, or they've got some weird agenda, or they think strange, or why do you want to involve yourself in all that when you've got a nice castle of a house up on top of a hill with everything and all the money you need? Why would you want to be involved with everything? And the people in that book are just horrible, wretched people.
Mm-hmm.
Horrible.
Well, I mean, you get that in a small town, though. I mean, the thing is, if a tragedy happens in a small town, I mean, for instance, we in Sackett's Harbor, where we were, we had this guy named Chicky. I don't know what his real name is. I'm sorry, but that was his name. And basically, he one day was driving in his car, got in a car accident with some young guy that was in the car with him. The young guy died. He parked the car in his garage sort of thing and lived in his house. And his house basically was falling down around him.
Right.
And he was like a social pariah, you know, right. And we all knew him as Chicky. You know, I never knew the story. It's just like, you know, he was the custodian at work and he used to ride his bike up and down.
So that story could be totally made up, ad-libbed. You just never know, right?
Well, the facts of the story are that.
Right.
But, you know, of course, you know, when I got older and I asked my dad before he passed, I go, what was the real story? Because he lived next door to my grandmother, and my grandmother hated his house because, you know, it was falling down. Well, it's just falling down. The garage fell down on top of the car. It was a really old new car that basically had never been driven since that fateful night. And right. The garage fell on top of it.
They did take the guy out of the car, right?
Yeah.
The dead guy's gone, right?
When I asked my dad what the real story was, apparently it's because this young guy might have been his boyfriend in 1950s.
Oh, yeah. Northern
so,
New York, even. Yeah.
So, I mean, but he was so pariah for all every, you know, the whole thing just because of that, you know, that whatever that story
that's
is.
That's sort
now,
of
whatever.
Like that lady they called the Witch of Watertown. She was a sweet woman and she just looked weird and they treated her abysmally.
Well, my grandmother told me the real story about her. And the Witch of Watertown's like, you know, everyone's like, oh, that's the Witch of Watertown and stuff like
that. You know
who
she reminded me of? She reminded me of that woman in Black Sabbath, the lady that was like this coming for her rings. That's what she reminded me of.
But,
that's
but
why it scared the shit out of me so much when I was little.
But do you know what her backstory is?
She's a burn victim, wasn't she?
No, she was a nun who was helping, who was hiding Jewish children in Europe. When the Nazis caught her, they tortured her to death. I mean, they tortured her and they burned her face.
Yes, they burned her. No, I knew
they burned her face and they scarred her. And basically she got liberated by the, you know, she was in one of the concentration camps and she's lucky to be alive. And then she relocated to Watertown and
of all
course,
places.
You know, and of course, none of us knew her story, and we always knew her as the Witch of Watertown.
And I was scared of her because she looked weird. And I feel bad all these years later knowing that story now, you know.
I know. When my grandmother told me the real story about her, like when I was like in my 20s, I felt like shit.
We knew it was Burns, but we didn't know why.
The thing is, our parents kind of perpetrated that story as well, though, you know what I mean, which is even worse. You know, it's like the whole small town basically just
evil. It's just people are assholes. They just are, and that's why I thought of her when I was reading this book, oddly enough, because you could really exchange these characters for different small towns all across America or where have you, because people are innately cruel. When they band together, it's a feeding frenzy for something. They do. Yeah. They're just mean. We're mean. The species just needs to be annihilated off the planet. But
well, you know, it's interesting what you're saying. When I was reading, there's like, for example, my sister lives in a small town still. And once she was driving, right, and she collision with another car. I don't know who was, just two cars did like that. And she appeared in the newspaper, and she was really angry, you know, because look, they don't have nothing better to do than just publish the, and then, you know, put blah blah blah. But the doctor blah blah blah. It's like, what? Because we were raised up in a big city where, you know, like if you crash your car, no one will never know.
Right.
Then what I remember when I arrived here to live in UK, I was living in a village, and it was like everyone knew everyone more or less, because someone's arrived. So who is that? That person that has arrived? Have you seen that person? Blah, blah, blah. Which for me is like when I grew up with my neighbor, we would say hello, goodbye, good morning, and that's all, you know, unless something particularly happened that you need to ask for help or ask something in particular. But otherwise, I mean, I never knew, I don't know, the story of the neighbor, right? And yes, it's horrible, you know. It's like because it's a small town and everyone knows each other, it's like a kind of like that right to know or to talk or to give your opinion when nobody have asked it, you know. It's like,
well, I had that situation on social media where one of our writers basically went to this blog person and came up with this horrible story about me.
Oh, Joe, the ginger.
Ginger nut of horror guy.
The thing is,
I woke up in the morning and I'm getting these texts, and it's like all of a sudden it's like all these people are like doing a witch hunt on me.
Yeah, it was terrible.
And the thing is it's like no one reached out asking for my opinion or anything like this. And you know, it took me a good 24 hours to figure out how I was going to handle the situation when I chose to ignore it and it went away. Google my name, it's probably still out there.
I haven't seen anything about that, but it pissed me off, I can tell you that.
Yeah, and I'm just saying, and, you know, when people want to go on a witch hunt, they can go on a witch hunt and they will, sort of thing. And it's like, not once did anyone reach out to me and go, is any of this true? They just assumed
it was true. Except for those of us who knew that it wasn't. Whatever happened to that ass hat anyway? Has he still got a blog?
Unfortunately, he got in really poor health, so poor thing.
Poor baby. No.
Poor son of a bitch. But I'm not bitter. Really, I'm not bitter.
You will never know what happened. You know, he fell under a car.
This guy was an obnoxious asshole. I have no problem saying that on the airwaves. Not at all. And the people that got him going, they're assholes too. And I also remember their name, but I won't say a word.
It's kind of funny, but some of the people who jumped on the bandwagon at that time, I've now come, you know, apologized. Oh, I want to work with you. And I was like, well, I don't do the literary agency anymore. I closed that sort of thing. That wasn't the reason why we closed it. No. It was too much of a pain in the ass. Yeah, it was a pain in the ass to do. But, you know, it just goes and shows you, even, you know, small town mentality is pretty much what you get through social media now, sort of thing. So it's kind of, you know, it's still.
Yeah, but it's more vicious. I guess it's bad enough that it's vicious in person, but social media has done something to us as a species and has turned us into crazy, mean assholes. Seriously, social media is probably,
well, although it's helpful and it's fun. That's because you can hide. It's because you can hide behind a screen anyway.
Oh yeah, everybody's got Facebook balls. I would love to meet half the people out there with the Facebook balls they always show. It's like, okay, you're behind a computer, you wuss. You
know, I mean, I live in England where confrontation's not a thing. And I confront people and they really hate me for it. I think, oh, you bloody American.
I think it's funny when you start, I always think it's funny when you butt in on one of my posts and start spewing facts. It just drives them insane. They cannot deal with facts.
It shuts them down, though.
Them up. It's just like facts. And they
it just shuts them silence. Down.
Yeah, I love it when you do that. It's funny. Mm. Sometimes we even make up facts to screw with them, and that works just as well.
What about yourself, Leandro? What are your thoughts of We Have Always Lived in the Castle?
Yeah, I really enjoyed the short book. I really enjoyed I really pay attention to the beginning, you know, it was like it gave you a really detailed like kind of list of things that they do, the way they used to do it. And I was starting to think, wow. And that when I read that, I thought straight away.
Before you go get away from the beginning of the book, did you, Leandro, or anybody else, I'm still trying to figure out, were these girls abused in the family? Because they're very nonchalant about
art. That's what I was sensing. Yeah, I was sensing that.
But I mean, they never really come right out and say it.
Well, there are a couple of things that are kind of odd, because first of all, she goes about they don't keep their money in banks because their father said that the bank system is evil. But at the same time, he's the head banker for the town.
So that's why they kept calling him a tyrant.
I
missed that part. I didn't get that he was the banker for the town. That one flew over me. Okay, that explains a lot.
So there's that.
That explains why other people hate them.
But he was also very, very pompous. And he sat there and goes, oh, there's no need for you to go down to the village because, you know, you're living up here in the wealth of, you know, and the good of wealth, you know, and all this other stuff. So, I mean, they're pretty much. Well, you know, I don't know if the children were, but the father was, and the father seemed to have a tight control over the mother and his brother and his wife.
Well, there's a patriarchal and isolationist and an anti-feminist theme kind of undercurrent to the whole book, and everything like the pipe or anything like the cousin was touching or whatever, everything was patriarchal because he was doing what the father would do when the cousin got there, the male cousin. So, I mean, it was really well thought out on her part how she conquered this book. It's really.
But she also sits there and says that Constance was dating a townie.
Yeah, the fireman.
So, so there's that question there about that. Maybe it had something to do. Maybe she's supposed to go out that night, and that and Merricat, you know, changed the sugar to arsenic.
And, they still don't understand why is she so mentally ill, though. They never really go into it. So I was asking Leandro since he was starting. Did you notice why Merricat was so evil? She's an evil little girl.
No, I don't think she's the thing is, I don't think she was evil. I think that basically is that whatever's going to happen, something bad with. The father is going to do something bad. And because the mother doesn't stick up for the kids, and the brother and sister-in-law are not going to stick up for the kids because that's right. Obviously they're living off everyone's living Bungie. Off the dad's money. Yeah. So I think that whatever's going to happen, I don't know. I mean, this is where Shirley Jackson, you kind of have to fill in blanks here because she gives you information, but doesn't give you a lot of information. And I put it together that maybe something happened, that maybe she's going to run off and marry the townsperson, which basically means that, you know, he probably would have beat her or something would have happened to Constance. So Mary.
His character didn't really seem very savvy. I mean, the character, the man, there was also the fire chief. that wanted to date Constance. He wasn't really nice, was he?
Well, but he wasn't nice. He wasn't nice because, you know, she gets accused of murder. She, everyone thinks that she, everyone in town thinks she's done it, and she gets off of it. And yeah, of course, that would, and of course, if he's dating her, that would have brandished his name as well. So that's more like you are either with us or you're against us in the town. So I think it has something to do with, and I think he was bitter because at the end of the day, he's probably thinking, why did he murder your parents? Because he's probably assuming that as well. When you want, we could just run off together and you'd never have to see them again.
Yeah, that would have made perfect sense too.
So I'm assuming that there's probably a lot of ambiguity going on there. And I don't think they had a, you know, once her parents end up dead, I don't think they had a conversation to break off their engagement or their relationship or whatever. Kind of like, oh, you know, you just killed your parents and you're going to court, you're going to jail, and now you've been acquitted. And now, you know, it's like,
yeah, but I mean, she even said they deserved it. So how did she get off? It's just like, I need juries like this around my life because she said they deserved it. What, you know,
well, the thing is that what you have here is that did she get off because there was not enough evidence, or did she get off because they had a lot of money?
Or a lot of money. Well, they don't, they seem to hate them. How did they even get a decent jury? You know?
Well, that's what the townspeople think, that she got off because she bought that. Maybe the townspeople might think that maybe they bought the whole court system off.
Well, the author made it sound like that she was too pretty and it would be a waste of life because she was like a crown jewel as far as, you know, being pretty or something.
Yeah,
you
know? I mean, I imagine she was probably very pretty and a ton of ugly people. So,
well, that's just the way it is for some of us, right?
Yes, I know. I mean, I've had that curse in life my whole life. You don't know what it's like.
But, it's like something that I really like got my attention was like this. I wrote it down to like put the things in the place where they belong. Right.
Right.
Merricat said in a point where we put things where they belong, and then I start to think, okay, but this goes from objects to me, right?
Right.
People, right? If someone tried to hurt me, I would put it in the place. I don't know. I start to think about, because, and I, as we discussed before, I imagine that something happened that we don't know between the parents and them. And I imagine that her sister know what has happened exactly. But we know that they were poisoned with arsenic, but we don't know why.
I think what we know is that Mary Kat didn't want Constance. She knew that Constance did not take sugar in her berries.
Right.
So she was, I'm assuming that we're supposed to put together that she was protecting Constance from whatever's going on.
Yes,
but we do get shades of what's going on with Julian and his madness.
That's what I was going to ask. What is going on with Julian's character? I mean, you get a little more of an idea of it in the movie because it's well done, but in the book, it's just like he really does seem he's fixated on the murders.
But why is it survivor's guilt, isn't it?
You're thinking survivor's guilt.
Well, the thing is why did I, how come I survived when everyone else died?
Because he didn't eat a lot of berries.
Well, that's not what you're going to think. It's not, oh, I had like a couple berries less than everyone else, so therefore I was spared. He was in a wheelchair and stuff like this because of it.
Right.
But you know, his wife, you got to remember his wife died and his brother died and his
sister-in-law
died. So, and then, you know, he survived, so he's got survivor's guilt. But at the same time, I think we have an idea that when Charles comes into the picture and then Julian's pulling against him sort of thing, that I think that kind of gives us an idea what the father was like, the way the father was treating Mary Kat, and was the way that Charles kind of mirrored that.
Yeah.
Because Julian's just like what Julian's saying to Charles's behavior towards Mary Kat. It's like, well, you know, you shouldn't be doing that. You're being patriarchal.
Oh God, and so talk on about and so forth. Talk about somebody you love to hate, Cousin Charles. Oh my God, what a douchebag that guy is. I mean, he was such an unlikable character. And you knew when he just showed up out of nowhere, you weren't going to like him. And he knew he was probably after stuff, you know? Because, I mean, he doesn't care about when the fire happens. Like, which I was kind of hoping that he would think that he started the fire by the pipe being dropped in the newspapers. But, I mean... to the book, you know, he's more concerned about the safe than he is about the girl. Don't worry about the humans of the, you know, in the house. Get the safe.
He just wants to get to the vault.
Yeah.
Well, everything about Charles is about the money, though, isn't it? That watch is worth a lot of money. That's worth a lot of money. What's she doing burying that in the yard? This is worth a lot of money.
Comparing to the other, I can't remember her name. The other girl, that she was saying, but she's burying some coins. It's okay. There's no problem. And it's like they're kind of like the idea that they're so rich that gold. Well,
I think another thing with Charles is that I think the reason why Charles, like Constance, lets Charles into the household. Because Constance under the impression that the only people you can trust are your family. Because
not
Julian,
so in this case.
Because of course that's not the case in any case, really. It's like, you know, you can't judge a person just because they're part of your family. You have to judge them on who they are as a person, really. But you know, and so therefore that's the reason why she lets him in, because this is our cousin, he's our family. We can trust him. Mm-hmm. And of course he's not to be trusted anyway. And, you know, and another thing is that, you know, Merricat is protecting Constance, but at the same time, Constance is protecting Merricat because she takes the blame for the crime.
Well, she all slipped up, though, with cousin. She was slipping up a little bit. She did take the blame. She was protecting her younger sister, who is 18, I believe, in the book. She's 28, I think. And, but you kind of wonder what was going on, because it seems like the romantic interest in Charles was happening. And I don't know what kind of, I guess a first cousin or whatever. I guess that was acceptable back then, first or second cousin. But he's on the take and she doesn't realize it. And Mary Katherine knows that something's going on with it. Yeah. Constance is just too innocent, I guess.
Then I wrote down control. Right. So if you want to have control over someone, you need an order and a system. And I think that that's what the father created in the house, like a kind of way of
patriarchal is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Doing the same things at the same time, every and all, never change, because that gives you the feeling of security. And then and for them, you know, that's I think that's why they didn't want to put the things in a different place or do something different.
Having control of your situation as well.
Well, they wouldn't have had control over their situation had Mary Kat killed the family. And then she sees Charles come into the picture and he's trying to insinuate himself as a strong male presence in that house. And that dog just isn't going to hunt, you know, with Mary Kat anyway.
Well, another thing is that maybe also you have to think of that maybe after the trial and then when Constance comes back home, you know, getting off with murder and no one knows what happened. Now they're ostracized by the town, and so the only control that they have, they don't have control of the outside world, but they have control of whatever they have inside their house. So right. That's why maybe that's the reason why everything has to be orderly as well.
It focuses around food too. Did you notice how everything is around that kitchen and around food and lunch and eating?
Yeah,
it's a real big theme in this book.
America knows a lot about chemistry, you know, like about fungi and
the mushrooms.
Yes, and which things are poisonous and which things you and again, you know, that she's doing like a magical.
She's practicing witchcraft, basically.
Where you need
a hedge witch.
Yeah,
she practices I think what she's trying to do is what most witches do, and they bury things all around their property and hex stuff. So, but I don't know. And then that book keeps falling out of the tree, the one she nails to the tree. So, I mean, that's when she knew something bad was going to happen. So what happens? Charles shows up.
Well, another thing about food and everything dealing with food in the kitchen and stuff like this is you got to remember that Constance is the mother or the caregiver now. She's the right. one that she's the caregiver to Julie, and she's the one that puts Julie into bed. She's the one that's making sure that, you know, when she tells Merricat, make sure you wash your hands, make sure you wash your face, sort of thing. And she's now, you know, she's the caregiver, the maternal one now. She's protecting everyone within her, and a mother's, and the mother is the queen of her castle, isn't she?
Yeah.
Which is that
they really don't talk about the actual birth mother at all, hardly, in this book. You get a kind of glimpse here and there of what you think things might have looked like, but it had to have been pretty bad for Merricat to want to poison all of them and Constance to cover for her.
I imagine she probably was a bystander for whatever is going on. The mother's the bystander. It's kind of like that thing where let's sit there and say, I'm not saying that the book says this, but let's sit there and say that there's sexual abuse going on.
Right.
And, you know, and the mother tends to know, but she, you know, she doesn't want to ruin her marriage or want to approach right. it. So she kind of lets it happen. But she knows.
Right.
You know, it could have been, you know, I'm not, you know, and maybe a physical abuse or emotional abuse. So, you know, for the mother not saying anything to protect her children, in a way, she's a bit complicit into the crime that the father might be committing, whatever that may be.
Man, is arsenic that readily available? You just go pick up whatever and just spritz
it. It's just rat poison, isn't it?
Yeah. Didn't this kind of remind you of a V.C. Andrews book for some reason? It was just kind of flowers in the attic.
Yeah.
There was a little flowers in the attic-y for me. Well, it did. It had that same vibe going on, I thought, a little bit.
Well, I mean, the grandmother in Flowers in the Attic does poison the mother, or the grandmother, depending on how you want to read it, poisons the kids with arsenic on the sugar cookies.
Yeah. I love the origin story. If you get a chance to read or see the movie, watch the origin story to that. It's really cool.
Yeah, I did watch it, actually. It's on Paramount, isn't it?
Yeah.
The origin story to Flowers in the Attic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which we will be covering at the end of the season.
Brilliant book. I love that.
What's that, Craig?
I love that book. I read it recently for the podcast.
Yeah, that's actually a good book.
But don't be a spoiler because I haven't read it, you know. Now you have to tell me all this story.
I'm telling you, you're going to like it. You're going to like it, Leon.
Looking forward to it. We need to talk about Kevin. That'll be good.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's next month sort of thing. Kevin. So, yeah. That's quite controversial in its own way. So anything else anyone want to add about We Always Lived in the Castle?
Did you guys get any good conclusion towards the end of it? I mean, there's just status quo. They're just going to live out of the vault the rest of their life on the top of the hill in a burnt house, wearing tablecloths. I don't understand why they're wearing tablecloths, I guess, and their uncle's clothing. So I guess they don't have any of that stuff.
The upstairs got burnt, didn't it? So,
right. But I mean,
I imagine the uncle, because he's in a wheelchair, his bedroom must have been on the lower level.
Right. So but they said Merricat said she was never allowed in there. So she ended up sleeping in the kitchen on that mattress they cleaned.
It kind of does end like in the future where kids are still coming out and taunting, and then she comes out and the kids run away.
They're playing in the yard. The gates are open. It's like a park now at the end of the book. And that's what I was like wondering what you guys thought about the ending of all that.
Well, I mean,
it seems like.
But she also sits there and says that they have become part of the village folklore now. They're a folk right. tale now. You know, the night and the villagers, you know, they try to accost them, and now they're leaving food on the porch every day.
See, there we go with the food again. They're the food fixation, because they are leaving food for them because they felt guilty. And it's just like, how could they not feel guilty trashing their home like that? I don't care how much you hate somebody.
And then they're content to live in the house.
And they're content to still hide in the house. Now they can live in massive isolation, you know, and then never go outside again. So, I mean, you got an 18-year-old and a 28-year-old young woman whose life is fried completely. So, I mean, they're never going to get married. They're never going to see the outside world. I mean, something's got to give. I wish she would have wrote a second book. I want to know what happens.
It was roller skating.
Another interesting thing about the whole thing as well is that they're living in a huge house. It doesn't look like a castle.
No.
After the fire, the turrets of the house are still standing. And the grind, which now makes it look like they're living in a castle. And if you live in a castle, and people live in a castle, if you look at the royal family or anyone who lives in the castle, what does that do? That further isolates them from everyone else anyway.
True.
That's a good view, yeah, because our castles are always like a place that you can access really easily. Sorry to interrupt, but it's like, you know, the castle always has like a what's the name? A fort, like a wall all around that you can trespass. And in this,
so you got a moat too.
Yeah. And if you think now, it's like when you can have access to a castle, when it's in ruins, like now, with the people went there, destroyed all, and it's like, yeah.
Every child I know is that you guys got a shit ton of castles over there. Every time I get a chance to come over to the UK, I have to visit a castle, no matter where it is. I'm going to go find a castle. That is such cool stuff, man.
But they're fortresses, and so the question is, with a fortress...
It is a fortress.
Is it to protect the people inside, or to make sure that so people can't get in, or does it make sure that the people can't get out?
But why? I just didn't understand the end of it, I guess, is what bothers me, because people are playing in the yard. The gate, I guess, is not lockable anymore. And they see that people are out in the yard. As long as they keep their distance, they let the kids play way out.
Well, they peek out at them through... I mean, if anything, they become more isolated and more agoraphobic than they were before. Because before, Constance would at least go out to the gate,
front yard, you know? Yeah.
But now, neither one of them are leaving the house at all, and the town through their guilt are sustaining them by feeding them, which is the same thing that Constance was doing with the family by feeding the family. Now the town are feeding her and her sister.
I would have liked a little more backstory on why so much dysfunction, but it's Shirley Jackson, so we'll never know.
Well, I think, you know, I think as far as, you know, whatever goes on inside a family, there's always some kind of dysfunctionality inside most families anyway. You know, not to this extent, but there's also dysfunctionality within a townspeople. Now, if you're living in a small town and you have a person who owns the town, then if anything bad should happen to the person who owns the town, then basically the townspeople are going to rejoice in the badness of that. But what we got here is that, you know, we got the townspeople revoking after the fire and go, let it burn down. And then it's like, and then all that pent up hatred towards this family all come out in the fire. But then what happens after that? What happens after you get in a fight and you beat the shit out of each other? Then the next day you start feeling really guilty about everything. And then you realize, like, ooh, we went too far. But you get caught up in the mob, the mobness of it all. Mob mentality.
Boy, mob mentality does get pretty scary, doesn't it? I mean, because people, seriously, they're like, it's like a feeding frenzy of sharks with blood in the water. And that, you know, and these people were just horrible people. I mean, just going in somebody's home and destroying and kicking them when they're down. Their house burnt down. So what do? They make it worse because they hate these girls so badly. And I just can't, I don't think I could ever be part of that kind of mentality. Really, I don't think I can do it.
Well, but you see mob mentality happens almost, you know, on a regular basis, whether it's like at a football match and two people start fighting. And next thing you know, it's like this turns into like a huge mob thing
Or summer of love over here in 2020. Yeah.
Or a bar fight.
Yeah.
You know, bar fight starts off.
I've seen quite a few of those, actually.
But a bar fight always starts with just two people. Next thing you know, it's like everyone's involved, you know, and they're all.
Not everybody. There's some of us that are still in our little booth watching all the festivities, you know.
Yeah, but the majority of the people are normally going after two people. They're being up two or three people. You know what I mean? It's like, and no one knows why they're doing it, but everyone's just joining.
They don't know why they're doing it either.
And because everything is connected with everything, but we don't know how. I tell you one story. There was in the Second World War times, let's say 1944, 1945, there were people in Argentina supporting Hitler. They were Germans that were living there, but they were sending a lot of money to Hitler's cause.
Well, that's because they were all sneaking over to Argentina to escape the Nuremberg trials.
Well, that was after the war, not during the war.
I can't remember exactly when, but it's, let's say, 1994, that they knew that the thing was like going to end soon,
right,
for the good or for the bad. And there was a town, little town in a province in Argentina, where they were building a massive, massive hotel. Imagine you build a hotel in a little town, nobody knew why. I was because
that's a true story. They actually were building this place.
Well, yeah. No, the place exists. The actual building is still
In ruins, okay.
But there has an elevator, like in the old days, and a lot of furniture, a lot of quality. Ended happening that the Second War ended,
right,
and the place never opened. And they knew in the town that there was the owners and the people who were contributing to building all this. They were all people that were Germans. So they were all thinking, okay, someone important is coming at the point. And then when this hotel never worked, never opened, nothing happened, then it is today well known that in the town, they said everyone in the town, in the house, has an object from that place.
Oh, they went in and pilfered a few
things. And they went and started to grab everything, the lamp, the forks, whatever. So there was a
story. I think that they did that also to the house of the Perones. I think they went into their palace and stole a lot of their stuff too. And then I think they did the same thing to Saddam Hussein, the Winter Palace. They went in there and started taking stuff out of there too. I would too, actually. If I knew the Germans were, you know, the Third Reich was building a posh hotel down the road, and they got their asses kicked in World War II, I would go loot the place too, because that stuff probably didn't belong to them to begin with. You know, they probably stole it from all these poor people they annihilated. That's a good story, though. I believe that. That's a cool story.
I mean, it probably was new stuff anyway, but the money probably was paid for by.
Yeah, they probably shipped it all over from wherever they stole, you know, from the museums and from people's homes. Mm-hmm. Interesting. That's really interesting. I'm going to find that place and look it up.
Yeah, it's the province is called Cordoba. There was a program on TV that I saw it, and there were two places. One was this one. I don't know exactly if they were building a hotel or a big, big mansion, but nobody knew why.
And what an interesting story.
There was another one that this one, yes, it was a hotel in front of the sea. Start to build a huge place, open for, I think, 2-3 months, then gone.
They stay
there still. The people saying that someone saw a submarine emerging at a point, and then they never saw it again. One of the theories was saying that Hitler went to Argentina, and because the country is so big, he never found it. But I don't know. But yes, it's true that they found a lot of Nazis after the war, going to Argentina and going to Brazil. So yeah.
Really interesting story. I'm going to have to look that up now because that's going to bug me. That's just, I like that little historical tidbit stuff. Thank you.
Well, I guess what we should do is let's rate We Have Always Lived in the Castle by Shirley Jackson. Starting with you, Vicky, how many stars would you give this book?
I'm going to give it 5 just because I like how she wrote about it, because Merricat, especially Merricat, just like, because I know how she feels. I don't want to go out there anymore either. And I mean, I'm miserable as soon as I get in the grocery store, and I don't make I'll bitch her. You know how I am. I do that in grocery stores around strangers. So, I mean, I get total sticker shock when I go shopping. But yeah, I really thought it was well written. I really enjoyed her characters because they really do resonate. And I like how she approached patriarchy without making it so PC, I guess is the word. You knew it was wrong, and you knew these girls were fighting against something, or something traumatized them, yet she brought it quite beautifully up in a way that it resonates with the reader. That's why I thoroughly enjoyed this book.
What about yourself, Craig? How much do you rate this?
I'd give it the book four out of five. It was a good read and just the right size, really.
Yeah. 10 chapters. Really I'm down. Really
nice. And what about yourself, Leandro?
5 out of 5. Well, basically, as Vicky said, it's really cool. Let's call it suspense. I mean, you finish and they say, okay, hold on, I want to know more now.
I know, she kept you interested. Why.
Yeah.
She did.
It was really, like, clever. You know, sometimes, you know, it happened that you read something and they say, okay, well, this is going down. But, you know, keeping it all the time. I like those little details that, like, those phrases that maybe you read it at the beginning and say, okay, this is the beginning of the book. And then you realize, okay, this is really important. That's why I wrote it down. And you said something really important, Vicky. They said, like, about that system, about patriarchal system. Once I read something that was saying, women are so clever that they can make men think that they have the power when they don't have anything.
Well, seriously, that's a smart woman can make them. I mean, seriously, look at all these dictators. Yeah, they got beautiful women mentioned. Behind them. You know, who's really, you know, pulling the purse strings and making all of the decisions? You got to win.
When I was studying English, I remember that the professor at that time brought us a little story. And I thought this was so clever. The story goes like that. There was a couple with two kids and they were deciding where they're going to go on holidays. So the kids said, we want to go to the beach. We want to go somewhere. And the dad said, well, let's see where we can go. So he said, well, okay. He said to the lady, go tomorrow to the tourist information shop and check what do they have, bring all the information. So she went and she chose the places where she wanted to go, grabbed the leaflets, took it back home. Deep down she knew, but wherever they were going to go, she would be happy because of the places that she had chosen first. She bring it back, give it to the husband. Said, okay, here you are. Let's see what we can choose. So he chose and said, okay, let's go here. This is the place that we need to go. And then she was really happy. Did done because
and she had already chosen the place.
Yes. And he felt that he was in power choosing. He didn't choose anything at all.
That's like in dementia where they taught me to, in the morning, if you're going to dress someone who's got dementia, don't just open the whole wardrobe and say, what do you want to wear? Because she'll be there for like 4 hours. But give them an option of two things to wear and then get them to choose one of the two.
That makes a lot of sense, though. That's sort of like with toddlers and stuff. Never give a toddler a choice. Children should never be giving any choices.
God. And the last thing, as you said, Vicky, sorry, it's like...
It's all right, honey.
It was really cool, like... Seems that the two characters are really antagonism, but I don't know at what point they are so different. I think they're like, both are, well, of course they have, there are something strange in their mind, right? One, I think, is like, feels that she has powers when maybe she doesn't have any power, but believing that she has power makes her feel more secure.
Well, you have to wonder, why are they so dysfunctional, you know? I mean, clearly there's a problem, so.
Yeah. And the other one reacts to problems like with a smile. And the smile is always bigger and bigger, like everything's okay, everything is super. And it's really interesting how the two opposite things like put together, like perfect. Oh yes.
It got voted the 10 best novel of 62 by Time magazine.
It was what, hon?
It was voted one of the best novels of 1962 by Time magazine.
Wow.
Really strange that they took so long to make a movie about.
Yeah.
No, there hasn't been any movies made. This was it, right? The one with...
Yeah, but it was 2018 and the book was written when? 1962,
61?
There was a stage play in 66.
Oh, no kidding. Okay, I didn't read that.
On the Broadway.
I mean, I'm going to give it a 5-star rating because I've read this book multiple times. I'm a huge Shirley Jackson fan. I got her... Everything that she's written.
I am now, I can tell you that.
And I like it because every time I read it, I discover more and more. You can reread it. They're easy reads, even like The Haunting of Hill House and The Lottery and For Susan and Sundial and all her other stuff that she's written, a lot of short stories, is that you can read them and, you know, you And yeah, every time I read them, I get something new out of them. And there's very few writers I can get that from.
I can see where you could read this book a couple times and find something different each time.
And I find it, when I read it like different ages, it's like I find out more and more, and I figure out more and more. So
you ever wonder, like with your college self, when you went and read these books in college, I mean, where your brain was, and then all these years later, it's just like, you know, you read it again, it's like, oh, well, you know, this now I kind of get it, I think. I mean, there's something to getting old, I guess.
Yeah. It's been like Catcher in the Rye, or when we did those classic novels that we did, that season of classic novels that we did.
Oh, I love those.
And, we read them, and then you know, Hunchback of Notre Dame and
Count of Monte Cristo. Who'd have thought? Yeah. You know,
yeah, and then you reread them, and now
I know that I know, like, Leander shaking his head. He loves the Count of Monte Cristo.
Yeah, that was, I love that. That was one of my favorite all time. That and Hunchback of Notre Dame were my two favorite books that we covered that year. So,
yeah, those are good podcasts too. I should go back and revisit, because Leandro he loved those ones.
they were difficult reads, but they were bloody fantastic.
Too. The Count of, I thought I was gonna like have to put a hollow point between my eyes. I mean, that was such a long book. I mean, that was an enormous book. It's like, damn, Keith.
I didn't realize how big it was until we started reading it. I mean, I'm reading a 900 page novel at the moment, so, which I'm loving. Jeez, at the moment. But
what is it, War and Peace?
No, the new John Irving book, the last
chairlift. Isn't that big?
900 pages, yeah.
Is it
loving
so far?
I'm loving every word of it, though. I'm 30% of the way through it now. The last chairlift.
The last bullet?
The last chairlift.
The last chairlift. Interesting. Okay.
It's excellent, so. Well, this brings us to We Have Always Lived in the Castle, the film, which is a 2018 American mystery thriller film, which was directed by Stacey Passon, written by Mark Kruger, and starring Tessa Farminga, Alexandra Daddario, Crispin Glover, and Sebastian Stan. It was based on the 1962 novel of the same name by Shirley Jackson. It premiered at the LA Film Festival on September 22nd, 2018, to generally favorable reviews. It was released on May 17th, 2019 by Brainstone Media. What we're going to do is cut to the trailer and be right back.
My name is Mary Katherine Blackwood. The Blackwoods have always lived in this house. And we will never leave here, no matter what they say or what they do to us. Never. Father built this gate to keep us safe, but it could not protect him.
My mom says you and Constance eat rats!
Holy witch!
People here believe Constance killed Father.
One of the true, genuine mysteries of our time.
There is such a thing as good taste.
Have you ever tasted arsenic?
What are you doing? I heard Father in his room. I feel him coming back. Merricat, it's our cousin, Charles Blackwood. He looks just like Father.
Has he said anything about leaving?
He's our cousin, and he'll go when he's ready.
His presence is a strange new spell.
We have many plans to make. That chair is my dead brother's chair. I'm
going to put death in all their food and watch them die. He was a very wicked man, our father. The world is full of terrible people.
Hello!
welcome back to Literature License Podcast. We're discussing We Have Always Lived in the Castle, the 2018 American mystery thriller film. And starting with you, Leandro, what are your thoughts of the film?
Well, I really like it. Again, there's something that really caught my attention, that when she goes to the shop the first time, I don't know if you, I realized later, but she was with a spoon and she was stirring the coffee over and over and over and over. And then she took the spoon. But I have the feeling that she took the spoon from her house to the coffee shop and then brought it back. Why? Because what do you need to put poison in the sugar? A spoon. So it's like you never trust, you know, the weapon that you commit the murder, you never. And then at that moment she was in the shop and there was a kid going running around in circles. I don't know. I always pay attention to those. I have a friend who said, you remember always the things that nobody pay attention about. But for me, it's like, that means something, you know, someone going around and around, and then they were having dinner. And then imagine that you start about talk about a subject, I start mine, and then you and the three of us are the same. Repeat, like talking at paro, that you, if you are out of the scene, you are like, what's going on? You know? So I imagine that for me was like when they were not comfy with the person they were with, each of them start to do their own kind of replay record. To avoid what was going, was happening. I don't know. I found it like that.
Didn't you get a kick out of watching her walk back from the store and she had that sugar and it was spilling out everywhere?
Yes.
She was in such a hurry. She was like, bucket, and that sugar was all over the place.
Yeah.
I was like yesterday years old. I texted Keith. I go, I had no idea Thaisa Farmiga was Vera Farmiga's sister. I did not know that was her sister. And then I kept looking at her and go, they gotta be related. So I looked it up and, you know, her sister's the one that was in The Conjuring, you know what I'm talking about. And she was in Bates Motel and that was her big sister. And she got her into acting and just like, God, she got her into acting just at the right time for American Horror Story Coven. So she must have been just like 18 when she did that, you know?
Well, she was in the first season of American Horror Story as well. She's the daughter.
Right.
In House.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right. I totally forgot about that. But I mean, who would have thought? And they got other siblings that are coming up now and acting. But I mean, it was just, she was the perfect choice for Merricat. I couldn't have found another actress that could have honed in on that character like she did. Because she's really a lovely young girl. And they got her with the braids and the nerdy pants and then the shirts. And, you know, I mean, she just pulled it off brilliantly. I mean, she really, I love her anyway. She's a great little actress.
If this movie was really old, I would have put the lady with Whatever Happened with Baby Jane.
Right.
I can't remember her name. I really love the names.
What's Betty
name?
Davis.
Yes,
Davis.
That face of crazy on another level.
She does have a face of crazy. I mean, if you look at her other movies, Betty Davis just was,
yes.
She had those eyes. It was those bug eyes. What it was, you know, Betty Davis eyes. So
yeah. Well, and then I found something like repetition here happens all the time. You know, like doing the same things all the time, the same way, and then as you said. When the cousin grab the girl and start to shake her, right? I thought, well, hold on, this situation probably happened before. That's why they react that way. You know, one defend the other one, well, kill him with a, what's the name of that crystal globe?
The crystal globe, a crystal ball thing.
Yeah. So I don't know, when I was watching that part, though, I have the feeling that this situation has happened before. Yes, and another thing is like I think that the two sisters know exactly what has happened because when they were after the fire, they were sitting in the kitchen and said, "Okay, we forget this, right? Yes, we forget it."
Also, like Chris McGlover, it's like a kind of like
the language they have that they know what they're saying. We are out. We don't know.
So Chris McGlover, though, I mean, is he just kind of mentally defunct now because in the movie because he was poisoned? And but it seems like he's got a side that resonates with sanity. And it seems, I mean, it's just kind of weird how he played it brilliantly too. Crispin Glover's great actor. And I really enjoyed him in this. And he just, I always think of George McFly every time I see him. That's never going to get out of my face. But he kind of got really handsome with age, actually. But he's actually a nicely seasoned actor now. You know, when you watch him do his directing and his and everything
else. I always remember him in Friday the 13th doing that weird dance.
Was that him?
Was he not in there?
Yeah, he was going like this, that really freaky dance. That's
oh my
him.
God, it was.
Oh yeah, I remember.
I think he was in the Charlie Angels, or not?
Yeah, he was in Charlie's Angels.
Oh,
as
that's
well,
right. Yeah, he kept ripping off everybody's hair and smelling it.
Yeah,
he's so good as a weirdo. He does. Yeah. He pulls off weirdo like no one
else. Is he?
Huh?
No, he's American.
He's American. Yeah.
Well, I have the feeling that he was trying to write the story and write what happened, but he couldn't remember it properly. So that's
funny how he kept bringing it up.
He was recollecting the story all the time and didn't know how to do it. I don't know.
I think it's because he doesn't want to. It's kind of weird because he wants to remember, but he doesn't want to remember.
Well, he's asking about the cigar. Did your father take his cigar in the morning outside? You know, I mean, he's got his brain is like a mile. He's trying so hard to write this story, like a true crime novel, I guess, is what he's trying to do.
Yeah, but at the same time, if he writes the story, he's going to have to, you know, basically point the finger at somebody, isn't he?
But isn't that why he always insists that Merricat died, too, but she's right there? Because that's like Cousin Charles. She's right here. You know, she's right here. But
yeah.
Who was that actor for Cousin Charles? He was kind of...
Sebastian Stan. He was...
Sebastian Stan, okay.
Yeah. I mean, what's quite interesting is, I mean, they have made some, it's very faithful to the book, except for the ending is.
The ending was different.
The ending's different because they kill Cousin Charles and they bury him, which just doesn't happen in the book. He just comes back and they refuse to answer the door.
Well, he dies of heart failure because of I thought smoke inhalation because no one really went to go get him.
Well, yeah. Well, he comes to the house. They don't answer the door. And then you find out later, it's like, we don't know if it's the next day or years later that he died at some point. But he didn't die near them or on the premises.
When the smoke came through the vent, I was like, oh no, he's going to die.
I know. I felt bad for him because he was like, he deserved to live. He really did. I felt so, so sad for his character.
I thought
he kind of had to die though, right. Didn't he? Really?
Yeah, he did. I mean, so the girls could achieve their utopia of dysfunctional freedom away from society.
Well, it's his death that stops the pillaging going on.
Right. The acknowledgement from one of the firefighters that he had died. And that, I mean, who does that to be? I mean, there are people I know that would be like that, actually, that would tear somebody's house limb from limb. There are just some, like she says in the book and in the movie, there are some bad people out there. And I don't think anybody is not susceptible to them, especially when you got a town that's against them the way they were. Like, you know, beating on that little girl as she was going into town. Well, she's 18, supposedly. But all she's doing is getting her library books and her groceries and wants a cup of coffee for crying out loud. Does people have to be so insanely cruel? You know?
But you also notice, and I think the movie kind of spells it out a little bit better than the book does. Then when she goes for the coffee and the guy and his friend are picking on her and the waitress is really nice to her.
Yeah.
But then instead of like the waitress saying anything to them, because it would put her in the line of fire, she goes, oh, you better go now, sweetie.
Well, she did tell him to lay off a couple times.
Yeah. But she knew that basically if you're not careful, you know, it's best for her to leave because otherwise, you know, you don't want to be going against this town sort of thing because, you know, that's another thing. You've seen how the town reacts to them. So are you going to be able to, if you move to that town, are you going to stand up to the town knowing that you could be the next victim?
Right.
So there's that as well.
Someone just needed a good high powered long rifle shot it above their heads. Nobody, I mean, does no one defends himself in this movie or the book, really? There is no defense. You don't have any police presence. And the only reason the house didn't burn down because, well, even the jerk firefighter realized he had to at least do that. and not let it burn down.
Well, because it's our job. Because we have to do this because it's our job. We don't want to do this, but this is what we're paid to do.
Right. So I mean, that was a little disenchanting too. I mean, that kind of, I don't know. It just shows the very worst of human nature to some extent.
Yeah.
And I think that, I mean, and people wondered why these girls were cloistered in there. I can't honestly say I blame them. Constance, though, they picked a perfect Constance because she's ethereal looking in this, you know, right down to dressing like the perfect housewife for dinner and you know, Cousin Charles, boy, I don't know what Cousin Charles' deal was in this, but how close of cousins are they and what is acceptable?
Well, you know, it's really interesting that this happened. Last week I was watching a TV program from Argentina, and there was a really famous model, an actress from Argentina, and she was telling that she, in one moment of her life, she fell in love with her cousin, right?
Right.
And all the people were like, "Whoa, wow!"
Right.
But someone is telling you national television, you know, and then she said the man who leads the program said, could you, because the program is called Now We Can Talk.
Right.
And then he said, could you tell us more about the story? Because, you know, it, for everyone is like not happening all the time, you know.
Right.
And then she said, well, look, it is so good. It is so good and feels so good that has to be bad because otherwise it would be like too good. And then he said, well, can you explain a bit more? And then she said, well, look, is someone that was raised the same way if their cousins are like really near, right?
Right.
From the same family, raised in the same way, that you know that technically you expect that because your family will look after you.
Sort of like the Wilkeses in Gone with the Wind.
And then she was saying, but it has to be bad because she says it's like kind of like it's so perfect it has to be bad.
Did they end up staying together or being
married? No, in the end something happened. I don't know. She said that now she thinks that for her it will be like a love forever, but the man now has a new partner. And then she said, well, look, I'm respectful and I will never go like kind of to him knowing that he has got married again, but they get on well and even now they're friends with the new wife and everything is cool. So
clearly they don't watch Game of Thrones where it's totally acceptable. Yes,
yes. Well, I mean, an interesting thing about this is that Charles is the son of Arthur, which is the brother of Merricat's dad and Uncle Julian.
So that'd be first cousins.
Yeah, they'd be first cousins. But the question basically is that after the poisoning and through the court case and stuff like this, what, did this side of the family just ignore them all of a sudden? I mean, his father died of a heart attack, and that's why Charles comes there, because obviously his father didn't leave him any money. But the question basically is like, so did this side of the family just ostracize them for the crime that happened?
There's no other characters, so apparently nobody wants anything to do with his family.
Because, you know, when Charles shows up, she goes, we haven't seen you since you were a little boy.
Right.
When we used to play together when you were a little boy. It's like, well,
he knows they're rich.
No, but what I'm saying is that, you know, where the crime that happened, the parents were poisoned along with the uncle and aunt, which is his two uncles and two aunts. So they get poisoned. You know, it's his father's brothers and sisters-in-laws who got poisoned. And what, they never made any contact during this whole bit? And the thing is, not like they didn't know, because apparently this was a huge headline news story.
Right, for back then, right?
You know, well, I mean, and the thing is, it's your family. I mean, the thing is, you know, sort of thing.
I would know if my family had poisoned
But I'm just saying, they're saying that Charles's family didn't reach out to Mary Kat and Constance whatsoever.
Yeah. Well, you can only have so many characters, but let's put it this way: isolation.
Well, no, I mean, but it could mean the simple fact that you know, you are now the embarrassment of the family. We don't want nothing to do with you. And Charles shows up because he says his dad died after his dad's death. So I'm assuming that his father didn't leave him any money.
Well, I guess if you remember when he was in the restaurant and they were looking at his car, that Merricat had keyed, by the way. At the second viewing, I noticed that. I watched it a couple times. But he goes, how much did that cost? And he goes, well, yeah, I won it aces high. So he didn't buy that car. He won it in a poker game, which kind of gives you a little glimpse.
He probably gambles his money away. So
yeah, so I mean, that gave you kind of a little nod to what he's like, probably. Yeah.
And I mean, he's there. I mean, he's there not to support the sisters or worry about his Uncle Julian. He's there just for the money. It's all about the cash, about the safe, getting the combination to the safe, getting the money inside the safe. It's all about the safe. But, you know, he has to play Constance to get that. And poor Constance hasn't had any human touch, since the crime happened. Her boyfriend left her.
Well, there had to be a little sexual tension, at least between them in the movie, because remember when he came in from the shower, she wanted to give him towels and they're standing there just kind of sizing each other up.
She's a bit over familiar with him anyway. It's like, oh, would you like to have a bath?
She seemed a little too cozy. So she's probably a virgin still, I'm assuming.
I mean, she's going to be socially awkward anyway. I mean, she's agoraphobic. She hasn't seen another person for 10 years since this all happened.
Six years since this happened.
So she's been closed off. I mean, well, then it's probably
so she
more.
She was 22 when the family died. She's now probably at least in the early 60s. Would you still consider old maid? Still kind of people think about that back then?
Yeah, but I'm saying that she hasn't seen anybody except for the townies who come in and check up on the family every once in a while, that couple.
Those goofy assholes, they said they come in and drink their tea and don't leave. She goes, don't talk about it. She goes, you promised not to talk about it. Mm-hmm.
But I think they make like regular visits anyway, I'm assuming, because, you know, they brought this other
once a week. I guess.
Yeah, and they brought this other woman just on the off chance who was a bit socially awkward anyway. But I mean, so this couple, I think, you know, kind of like trying to get them back into society and everything like this. So I don't think they're busybodies. I think their intention is good behind it all. It's like, oh, you know, they'll move on from this.
They just don't seem like, well, maybe the man who's upset actually when they start just destroying the house. He's upset about it. I think that the sister of the mother actually cares. And that's who these people are. But there's just not something wholesome there. I mean, it doesn't appear like the purest form of familial love.
Well, I mean, but if you think of what is said, I mean, after the, when they come back to the house after everything happens, after the traumatic thing, and she goes, we got to get them out of the house, you know, and, you know, she goes, you know, don't worry, everyone's going to forget about this, you'll be able to live a normal life. And she kept saying that over and over all the time to them. You know, and the reason why she was upset with her friend mentioning about the crime is like, you know, they don't need to be reminded of this. They need to get back out in society. They need to even get back out there. And I think their intentions are good. I don't, you know, they're not there for the money. They're not there for anything but trying to get the sisters out there. Right. And then the husband, and I think what ends that is the husband goes, for God's sakes, they're grown women now. You got to respect their wishes now. You know, and
well,
so
you would think after what they did to him, because it was a total assault on somebody's home. And I mean, it already burned. And to add insult to injury, somebody also dies in their family because they're the heart failure, I guess the uncle died. And on top of that, they're destroying their mother's memorabilia.
But that's not the couple. That's not the couple coming to visit, because when they pull up to the house and they're seeing everything going on, they're trying to stop it. They're trying to stop, you can't be doing, stop it. You know what I mean? It's only when he fires the gun in the air that they stop. Sort of thing. Right. So that's why I'm saying that couple, I think, are good people, actually. I don't think they're not there for the money, not like Charles is. I think they actually do care about them, and they're trying to get them to have somewhat of a normal existence outside of their house.
It was never gonna have again. Yeah, it was really shocking for me when they were dressed. Mary Kat said, are you dressed like mom and dad? And the casting was wearing her dad's clothes, and then the lady was dressed like as mom, and I was like, "Whoa, that's weird."
Mm. Well, and then you see her. I guess Mary Kat's having a flashback of her parents are sitting in the chair while she's out there hiding by her little spot. Mary Kat's always been our favorite daughter. We let her do anything. We don't punish Mary Kat. Like I said, the actress that they got for this part was perfect. This part was written for her. I don't care what anybody says. She's just excellent at it.
But I think you also got to, Constance doesn't have a personality of her own anyway.
Not much of one.
You know, I mean, she might have had a personality before this happened, but now she has a choice. She can't be herself, because if she is herself, she's the acquitted murderer, even though she didn't commit the crime. But she was going to be. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to adapt, you know, the mother role. I'm going to adapt a personality. And then, of course, when Charles comes in and Charles adapts the father personality, Constance already has the mother personality anyway. It's like, oh, and I think this is kind of where we kind of mirror what their parents are like, you know, where, you know, Charles is acting more and more like the dad is what Merricat says. And all of a sudden, Constance, I think, is mirroring how her mom was reacting to everything. So I think, you know, we get that in the book as well, but you get it, of course, it's more visual in the movie. So I think that's what most of the story is right there, is that basically Constance is acting the way the mother acted when the father was abusing the daughters or whatever he was doing to the daughter.
Something happened there. I mean, where they had this massive rejection of anything masculine. And sort of like to the point where Merricat, I mean, I would not have wanted to be Cousin Charles in that house, especially if there's arsenic flying around in there. And he was eating like a pig too. I mean, there we go with the food again. But I mean, it was all about food. And I mean, he trusted, I'm going to eat this wonderful meal that Constant made. You know, I mean, I mean, it's all about food. And he was wearing the father's clothing. He was smoking the father's pipe. You know, I mean, he was trying to totally insinuate himself into their life.
Didn't call your attention when they were dancing. And then she said, would you like to eat, what's the name?
Gingerbread?
No. Yeah, but that part, when she asked, how do you say this and that in Italian? And she
said, I
would like to prepare you lamb with I don't know what.
That was roasted the same, lamb with onions and potatoes or something.
That was the same food that they were eating when the parents... having that dinner.
Yes. So, yes. Oh, you are right. I didn't even pick that up. Oh my god, yeah.
Somebody's planning something.
Yeah. But wow. Her sister became her sister became disenchanted with their life there for a little bit though, because you're kind of wondering, oh my god, she wants to marry her cousin or something.
Well, no, I think the whole thing is that they're so used to routine. You know, and you get it to the simple fact, like, you know, you need to go back to the store again. I only do this on a Tuesday.
Yeah.
You know, and, and with the cousin coming in, the routine is all in disflux. Plus, you got someone who's supposed to be a guest in your house taking over.
Yeah.
And then of course, what you also have is you got the guest who's taking over, becoming your father, while your sister is becoming your mother, what your mother right. was like.
That's exactly what was going on. That's really just who. That was so
and if you notice what was going on, whenever Charles was having a go at Merricat, and this is why I think this is what happened, what the reality of this situation is, that Constance was in the Merricat situation. The father would have a go at Constance and go overboard and go after her and start yelling at her, complaining about her and stuff like this. And the mother going, well, you should listen to your father.
Yeah.
You know, and all that sort of business. And I think, and I think that's basically what the whole situation was. So I think what you're seeing, how Constance and Charles is acting towards Merricat, is the reality of what went on before the poisoning with the father and the mother towards Constance.
Right.
And maybe the spells and the superstition and that she was casting was almost not cementing, but it was restricting her as well for her own movements, because, you know, she would only think that she'd only feel that something couldn't happen if something was contained. You know, if the book was nailed to the wall to the trees, for example, so then something would be contained. And then when it broke down or was moved, then she became quite vulnerable and quite insecure.
It's OCD as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is like you have that because you want total control. And if something takes that control away, you pretty much start losing it.
Mm.
You know, and Merricat is all about control anyway. It's like, you know,
it's just the heck... as bad though, really, when you think about it. Everybody wants to control Constance.
And poisoning.
Even her sister.
A controlled way to die is by poisoning someone at a certain time with a certain amount of
right.
poison and in a select time and the food, and you have to prepare it. And it was quite methodological.
It was definitely premeditated. There's no doubt.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's, you know, I would imagine with Constance and with Julie and Merricat before the uncle shows up, as I imagine they get up at the same time every single day. Breakfast is on the table at this time of day. Lunch is on the table at this time of day. She starts lunch at this time, you know, the exact, and I bet you it's like right down to the minute every single day.
Just be wary when someone offers you any berries, just like in Hunger Games, just avoid.
Oh, shit. Mm-hmm. What was it with the berries in the Hunger Games? I forget.
The last option to take before or you'll just wither away if you're hungry in that room, or you'll die anyway.
I totally forgot about that. I haven't seen the Hunger Games in a long time.
I really love the cinematography of this movie. I think the cinematography was by Piers McGrail. Mm-hmm. It was absolutely beautiful. Like the panning shot from the village or the town reminded me of the Emmerdale farm sequence where it looked like a miniature village. And
that's
then
what they look like in New England though. The villages do look like
so
that.
Beautiful. And the panning shots that they did with the depth of field was absolutely beautiful.
It was kind of pretty, wasn't it?
The way they got the stars shot as
this
well.
This was actually filmed in Ireland.
Was it filmed in Ireland? Because that looks like something right out of Vermont, New Hampshire.
Yeah, no, it was filmed in Southern Ireland. I'm not exactly sure where.
Well, it's very pretty village, wherever it is. But that house is just fantastic. I mean, God, yeah, I would just give my eye teeth to live in a house like that. I wouldn't want to clean it, but I'd like to live in it.
In County Wicklow.
Oh, interesting.
I went to Ireland this year. It was absolutely, I went to Bantry in Cork and it was absolutely beautiful.
Ireland is just so pretty. They're just so nice.
And the Gulf Stream as well. So the weather was really nice.
And where else can you find semi tanker trucks full of Guinness other than Dublin? Look at all the beer. There's just beer everywhere in Dublin.
we should get together for St. Patrick. Not next year, maybe the year.
Hey, I'm down for a trip. I'm telling you. I keep canceling my trip to the UK because they all keep getting weird strains of COVID.
I lived in Limerick for a year before
Did you
I
really?
Moved here. Oh, yeah, I
Limerick,
met cows
New York
there
or Limerick?
Limerick, Ireland, called Stab City. I milk cows and I basically worked in a restaurant called the Texas Steakout where I had to dress as a cowboy with gun holsters and go, "Hi, would you like to have some steak? And what kind of steaks would you like?"
I would pay to see pictures. But,
I got photographs of me and my cowboy.
There's a restaurant
like
in London that I've been to once or twice. And it's a, like a Texas restaurant, and it's got the pictures of the cowboy boots and the horse paws or hooves walking up the stairs, and that place is still there, but y'all make some weird tacos.
Sorry, question, but where are cowboys in USA? In which state?
Texas.
Just Texas, because I was living in North Dakota, and we have...
North Dakota, Montana, Wisconsin.
So this is all like a region, right?
The Midwest.
Anything, you know what? Wherever the cattle drive country is, coming all the way down from Saskatchewan, even all that, all the way down to the southern tip of Texas, all cattle country, or used to be.
Yeah.
We still got a ton. We got the 4-6's ranch down here.
Yeah.
About two hours south of us. Yeah. That place, they have their own post. They've got their own postal.
I was living in a town called Medora in North Dakota. And it was 7 blocks in the middle of nowhere, but everything, all the buildings were looking like the Far West.
Right, right.
Yeah, it was really, really cool.
And it's cold as shit there, too.
Well, no, I'm the lucky person that the year that I went, there was no snow. These 50 centimeters or maybe less, 30. When they said the year before was like a meter, and that I wanted to go to a place like that. But well, no.
Oh, it's just beautiful there. I haven't been so long. Yeah. I really felt bad for these girls in this book. But then on the other hand, how do you feel bad for somebody who just poisoned their whole family? I mean, things are bad, but I mean, how bad could it be? Now, if the guy was a sexually abusive father, I would have poisoned him.
Well, Merricat also tells you a lot about the father had them in fear of the town anyway. He built the gate to keep them in and keep them out. That's why the gate was there.
So maybe daddy was agoraphobic a little bit, or how you were saying.
Well, then he said the townspeople are stupid and thick, basically, and they're just scum.
Did you look at them? Did you see how they were acting?
Yeah, but I'm saying, he's saying this before they were he died.
But he said they kept calling him a tyrant and a bully and everything else. I mean, daddy had already set up the pretentious.
Yeah, whatever. And that's what they're saying. The girl, Merricat, I mean, you know, she was 8 when, you know, 10, I guess, when the crime happened.
She's 18 in the book. She's next because she's
6 years. 6 years ago, so she was 12.
Oh yeah, so that really that puts it in perspective. She does her whole family when she's 12. What does that say? You know, so something seriously is amiss in this family. That's living in
she's born with a fear of the town, and Constance has a towny boyfriend as well, which wants to like really set everything. How did this happen? How did she meet this person?
How did that happen? Because in the movie they didn't really explain it. She was dating the fire chief guy in the movie.
Well, you know, she was dating in French, but the question is, we don't know how they met or what was going on, but we know that she's the day that her parents got poisoned was the, she's supposed to go on a date with him.
Okay. I couldn't remember, but he kind of was I don't know. She's sitting there minding her own business, having a cup of coffee. And I mean, you know, come on, don't bully a young woman.
I'm just sitting there saying that. I'm not saying that she deserved to be bullied or that kind of situation. But I'm also saying that she has a fear of the town, and the town have a fear of her.
But there's a lot of mental illness throughout this whole novel, throughout this whole movie. I mean, that's just mentally ill. I mean, Constance is like a Stepford wife, no matter who she's the daughter of or married to.
She's agoraphobic at the beginning. I mean, anyway.
You know, she's all excited over getting out to the front yard by her garden, you know.
I think one day I'm going to make it past the gate. One day I'm going to make it past the gate. 6 years she hasn't made it past the gate.
Well, huge house, you know. Don't be like that.
It's been like Sam Smith. Can't do it. Isolation and COVID. It's just so horrible. As he's living in his 18 bedroom house mansion. It's like, it's really tough for you.
No kidding.
Remember the gingerbread persons.
And who ate the gingerbread? Did you notice they did a shot towards the gingerbread men that they just kind of left there out in the open? Yeah. I mean, was there something going on with the gingerbread men? You know, I mean, because that's an easy place to sneak in arson. They were
for the local church fate.
Yes. Mm.
But I mean, the thing is, it's all about. But the weird thing about it is that at the end of the story, sort of thing, what could have been a freeing experience for them, where they can actually leave the gate and they go and they can lead lives outside, what happens is whatever happens. Within this situation for them, because one or two things are going to happen. You're going to be extremely free because everything's been burnt down and you start a life anew, but they don't start life anew. If anything, they become even more secluded. And now instead of roaming around in a big house, they're roaming around in 3 rooms.
Yeah. That then the house is decimated basically. I mean, you know, the ceiling lights are all gone.
Everything. Well, she's not even going to the shop anymore.
Yeah, so I guess are we supposed to believe that the townspeople are going to keep them fed?
Yeah, they kept bringing food to the
die. I mean, I'll be realistic, somebody's got to pay the bills. Somebody's got to be taking care of this stuff.
Well, I mean, the thing is we don't know how
we're not supposed to be realistic. That's how my brain works, though.
To be honest, they could be taken care of for the rest of their lives, and there could be some person who's paying all that for them anyway. Right. I don't know. They pay cash for everything because it's in the safe, and the safe's still there, but I'm not sure what happens.
She's got money buried all over the house, too. I mean, she's got all those coins. Cousin Charles is really upset about those coins he found in that box, you know?
It was coins, not normal money. What he said, I don't know.
The big telling of the story basically is that they don't even venture outside the house anymore, and they spy on who's ever outside through the peepholes within the vines and the holes in the wall.
And they're wearing tablecloths, okay? Don't forget that in the book they're wearing tablecloths, that they have no clothes.
They don't venture out. It's a bit like Grey Gardens, which we'll be covering next year, right? which is a documentary about two real people who kind of live like this. But
that should be interesting.
And how do you think we're taking the book down?
Well, they're the cousins of Jackie Onassis.
Really interesting.
Who?
We're covering a documentary next season called Grey Gardens, which is about a mother and daughter who basically used to live in this great big house that basically has crumbled around them, and they still live there till the day they died.
And that Onassis family, that is some messed up stuff, man. If you read everything that went on with the Onassis family, you know, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, well, this is Jackie Kennedy's own family, Jackie Boulevard.
Oh, so this is Jackie O's family. It's not Onassis's family.
No, it's a real family, so I think so. You know, people seclude themselves off. And what happens is we get left with a story where basically they're more secluded than they were before. Even Merricat's more secluded because she's not even leaving the three rooms. Neither is the.
So this is probably the end of the Blackwood family, because no one's going to get married. Nobody's going to have children. These girls eventually are probably going to be institutionalized because somebody's going to have to wipe their butt later on in life.
And well, we know that Charles doesn't end up with anyone because he dies of a heart attack. In the movie,
that was the uncle died of a heart attack. Charles is fine.
Yeah, well, in the book, he's fine. In the movie, they kill him and they bury him in the backyard, so.
Well, the uncle, not Charles. Charles they put in the backyard?
Yeah, Charles, yeah.
Cousin Charles?
That's who they bury at the end of the movie.
Oh, we're talking Crispin Glover.
No, Charles shows up at the end of the movie, and basically, and this is where it differs from the book, because what we got is he goes and has a go, and then Constance kills him. America and Constance bury him in the back garden. Yeah, but it's snow globe.
Oh, wow. How did I miss that?
And then what we get, and then it goes back to the book, is that we get the first time that
The snow globe. Oh my God, yeah, that's right. She beats him over the head with it, and because he attacks Constance, but that didn't happen in the book. Okay, I got confused for a second. Okay.
But what does happen in the book and in the movie is that Constance tells Merricat, "I love you," and that's the first time she's ever said that to her.
And they only speak of the murders just that one time.
And to be honest, I think that, I think basically is that they knew that, you know, that they always took care of each other no matter what. That's what the thing is. And at the end of the book and then in the movie, two sisters just going to take care of each other.
Makes sense. So. I just can't imagine wanting to live my life. I mean, I like seclusion to some extent, but you got to live. God, man.
Oh, I could be quite happy in seclusion, but not with a family member.
No. No.
I love my family, but I don't love my family. So.
Yeah, gotcha. Love my kids, but glad they're out of here.
I live in a studio flat, right? And it's really small, right? So before lockdown, I didn't like to be here because I was feeling really like trapped. right? Because so I was going out all the time. I was working, I was going out to the gym, I was going to visit friends, but I was here just maybe, I don't know, to eat something, go to sleep, and that's all.
Right.
When COVID happened, you know, I have to be here, no, I didn't have any choice. So then I put internet and I started to stay here longer. And now I've reached the point that I enjoy being here and I'm not going out, not much.
We can't afford to go out over here.
Everything is so expensive that it was like, I lost it.
Exactly.
So I thought,
I've been like that for a while. I hate people, so.
Yeah, that's why I was texting Keith. Like, oh, I love this book already because I hate people too. I have no problem staying away from people.
No, I like what Mary Katherine said. She said, the world out there is beautiful. It's amazing. What is wrong is the people.
Yeah, the world is full of people. That's what's wrong.
So let's rate. We all have to live. We always lived in a castle. Starting with you, Craig. How many stars do you give? We have always lived in the castle.
I'll give it very enjoyable movie, beautifully shot. And I'll give it 5 Merricats out of 5.
5 Merricats.
And what about yourself, Vicky?
I'm gonna give it 5 too. I loved it. I just love the actors and the actresses. And Craig's right. It was beautifully shot.
And yourself, Leandro?
Yeah, 5 out of 5. Due to the how they chose the characters, like the actors, really good. I love that we don't know exactly what's going to happen next. And sometimes, you know, I like it when that thing happens because like an open end. I was thinking, okay, will they repair all the house with all the money that they have in the safe?
I know, that's what I was thinking. They probably got well, the equivalent of millions in there, probably, I'm assuming. Why not have somebody fix the house? But they're not going to, because that means they're going to have people have to deal with people, so that's not going to happen.
And they should just buy a mobile home and just put it on the lot.
Well, in the book, they had a summer house out back, didn't they? And then they just let it go. I would just move into the summer house and clean it up.
Yeah. I really like from the movie when at the end, when the boys were shouting things, and she did the opposite. Before she was locking everything. Now she started to open everything and she stand up and they run away. She didn't do anything, but. So that, I don't know, I like that thing. So yes, 5 out of 5.
I'm gonna give it 5 out of 5 as well. I have to sit there and say this is the only other book or story by Shirley Jackson that's been filmed. The first is Be the Haunting, which is a fantastic, and this is like,
they haven't made any other movies, is this it? Just these two things? There haven't been any movies, but no one's made a movie, The Lottery.
Nope.
How do you not make a movie of The Lottery? Because I mean, that's just waiting to be made, literally.
There is a school film on it, because the first time I became obsessed with The Lottery is that we had to read it in school. I was like, I think I was like 12 when we had to read it. And then there's, you know, when they would bring out, then they do a special film of the like a short films. film for a school film. And it was one of those scholastic. It's something like Children's Film Festival, but it was too gory for Children's Film Festival. And I just remember seeing it. And it's available on YouTube, so you can see it. It's only about 20 minutes long.
I know, but I want to see somebody really do something with it.
Yeah, but
like now Bambi, like they're going to redo it. They're doing a redo of Bambi now. You know, they're kind of in the vein of what was it? The Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey. People are all upset over it. I'm just like, yeah. And now they're going to do something with Bambi. And everybody's upset because they're taking America's childhood away. I'm not for that either. But some of us adults want to see Bambi's hunter who shot Bambi's mother. We want to see him get fucked up.
You know, I've never seen the movie.
Bambi. It's a beautifully animated film, Bambi.
It is, but somebody's of course gonna go the extra mile. But I mean, getting back to The Lottery, that would make an awesome movie. I have seen
the sequel to Bambi called Bambi versus Godzilla. Have you ever seen that?
What was it? Rated X?
No, no. Basically, it's Bambi, and he's like out in the field, and he's eating, and it's, you know, it's very, and the sun's shining, everything like this, and all of a sudden, Godzilla's foot just like stomps on him, and that's the end.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
How Cloverfield is that? I swear.
No, it's just, but it's called Bambi versus Godzilla. It's just Bambi.
That reminds me of Charlie the Unicorn. Charlie. Yeah.
But yeah, so I'm going to give this a solid five. And I sit there and say it's a brilliant adaptation as well.
It is really well. I would have liked to have seen the ending played out a little more, but
I think Shirley Jackson, from my understanding, Lawrence Hyman, when we interviewed him, this was going in production when we interviewed him, and he was very excited by it, and he was very much a part of it. So I think that helped as well, that her son was involved in this. So I think this is what kept it quite good. Well, this brings us to the end of the Literary License Podcast. Next month, we'll be covering Let's Talk About Kevin by Liv Schreiber, which we'll also be covering the film, which the film came out in 2011 and was up for multiple awards. So that'll be something interesting. And it'll be quite controversial. So, you know.
Controversy is us.
Yeah. But then, of course, next week we'll be covering Doctor Who, we'll be covering The Edge of Destruction, which are the episodes between 8th of February to 16th of February 1964. And, of course, we'll be also continuing our Batman the Animated Series. So we'll be covering I Got Batman in the Basement, Heart of Ice, Cat in the Claw, Part 1 and Part 2. Our remake will be the fantastic 1961 West Side Story and a Spielberg remake from 2021 of West Side Story. And our M&M Monsters and Mad Men for our Christmas special will be Cannibal the Musical, directed by Trey Parker and Matt Stone from South Park, and Paul Barton's Eating Raoul from 1982. And of course, before we bring in the new year, Dark Shadows will be returning as Tom has come back into the fold after a long illness. So we'll be back with Dark Shadows. So it's good night for myself. Good night, Craig.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, Leandro.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, Vix.
Good night.
And it's a Merry Christmas to you all. We'll see you next month in the new year for we all to talk about Kevin.